स्टूडियो वन वाली लिंक है मैडम।
हाँ मैंने कर दिया।
जी मैडम आप स्टार्ट कर सकते।
मुझे वो आने दो, कंफर्म नहीं हुआ। बाय जो बाय। जो इमरजेंसीज यू आर कवरिंग अदर देन व्हाट यू टोल्ड मी इन द मॉर्निंग, बस वही है।
आधे सर कवर पाई मांगी सर।
नहीं वो तो उन्होंने क्या सर्जिकल की थी ना।
सर्जिकल बर्न्स एंड ट्रॉमा विल बी डेल्ट बाय,
ट्रोमा तो ऑलरेडी हो चुका है।
हेड ट्रोमा बाय शीला।
अभी रुको रुको एक मिनट। चल स्टार्ट कब हो रहा है।
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरी वन। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द टॉपिक ऑफ मेडिकल एमरजेंसीज। वी आर क्वाइट फेमिलियर रिगार्डिंग दिस मेडिकल एमरजेंसीज इन आवर पीड्स कैजुअलिटी। द आउटलाइन ऑफ क्लास मेडिकल एमरजेंसीज, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डील अबाउट द ड्राउनिंग, पॉइजनिंग, फॉरेन बॉडी एस्पिरेशन, रेस्पिरेटरी एमरजेंसीज एंड स्टेटस एपिलेप्सी। द मोर्टैलिटी एंड मॉर्बिडिटी आर हायर अमंग द चिल्ड्रन ड्यू टू देयर इनएडिक्वेट ऑर्गन रेस्पॉन्स and ability to cope up during emergencies. The various common pediatric emergencies we can see in our day-to-day life are drowning, poisoning, burns, falls, injuries, and ingestion of foreign bodies. Drowning, it is defined as death due to suffocation from submersion in water. There are two terms while we discuss about this drowning we are considering. One is near drowning and another is wet drowning. In the near drowning, it is a term which is used when submersion victim who survives. And the wet drowning, it is a term used when the fluid is aspirated into the lungs. The most childhood drowning occur in freshwater, bathtubs, swimming pools, ponds, large buckets, washing machine, toilets and tanks. In adolescence, drowning occurs in lake and rivers. There are three categories for near drowning. In category 1, who are the patients awake and conscious. In the category B, the victims are stuporous posture, have respiratory distress, cyanosis and hypothermia. In the category C, the patients are comatose and may be in decorticate, decerebrate or flaccid state. They ultimately develop respiratory failure and apnea because there is an insult to the brain. So there will be decorticate and decerebrate posture. The pathophysiology of this drowning. Due to the aspiration of this fluid, there is failure of this respiratory status and it will lead to the death and immediate asphyxia following laryngeal spasm that may be lead to other complications like pneumonia.
Slow, slow, slow.
And voice.
Space.
The reaction to the submersion include panic attack, frantic, it means the mixed emotions like anxiety, fear that will be present and also the struggling for the life, an attempt to hold the breath, then also gasping, vomit and aspirate vomits, then laryngeal spasm will be there, unconsciousness. The complications of this drowning include aspiration pneumonitis, altered alveolar capillary membrane because there is a fluid shift and also the formation of protein-rich exudate which will lead to the colonization of microorganism. Further, it will lead to infection. The pre-hospital management, it includes the treatment begins at the scene of accident with the rescue and removal from water. Assess the child's airway, breathing, circulation and also assess for hypothermia. In order to prevent the hypothermia, remove all wet clothes and cover with a warm blanket. If the child is unconscious, we have to provide the CPR following the CAB approach, in which first we have to assess the scene safety. If the child is unresponsive, if it is the scenario, it is with a due rescuer, shout for nearby help. Then first rescuer remains with the victim and the second rescuer activate the emergency response system and also the AED. And next step is look for the normal breathing and check the carotid pulse and determine within 10 seconds. If there is normal breathing and pulse, then place the victim in a recovery position and wait for the emergency response arrive. If there is no normal breathing and there is no pulse, then provide rescue breathing. Then one breath every 3 to 5 seconds and 12 to 20 breaths per minute. And also activate the ERS. Then continue the breathing. Also check the pulse in every 2 minutes. Begin CPR. Continue it. If there is no breathing and only gasping and there is no pulse, then we have to carry out the CPR. Rescue cycles in 30 compressions and 2 breaths. And if there is two rescuer, the next rescuer who has arrived there, then the rescue compression and breathing ratio at a ratio of 15:2. And after arrival of this emergency support system, then attach AED and check the rhythm. If the rhythm which is shockable, then give shock and resume the CPR immediately. And there do not have any time lag. And if it is the analyzed rhythm that is non-shockable, then do not give the shock, resume the CPR. The management in the hospital, the before scenario we discussed in a out of hospital. If the patient is in the hospital, first immediately clear the airway and oxygen at a rate of 8 to 10 liter per minute. Then if required, provide the mechanical ventilatory support. Then the stomach content should be aspirated. Monitor the circulatory status, also measure the BP monitoring, central venous pressure monitoring to know the hemodynamic status, ABG and pH should be monitored. And also they keep the IV line open, administer diuretics in order to prevent the pulmonary edema, sodium bicarbonate to treat the metabolic acidosis. And also if there is convulsions, administer the phenobarbital like and also the diazepam, phenytoin. Then for the management of hypothermia, remove or wet clothes and cover with a blanket. Then fluid and electrolyte correction must be done. The prevention of this drowning, the parents and caretakers, they must be aware of the danger and depth of the water. The parents and caretakers, they never should allow leave the child unattended. Keep the bathroom doors and the lavatory seats must be closed. Fence around the swimming pool and also always keep lock the gate. Next condition is the foreign body obstruction, in the which can be seen most commonly can be seen in the children and younger than 15 years, especially between the children of 1 to 3 years, they are more susceptible. The etiology for this is they lack the this younger children who is in a age of toddlers. Their molars will be poorly developed and they have poor grinding for the food. They tend to running, playing. So during that time, if they have placed anything on the mouth, there will be chances of aspiration. And also usually they there is a habit of putting everything on the mouth and the lack of coordination of swallowing and glottic closure. These are the common reasons for this foreign body aspiration. The pathophysiology is the food items are aspirated. Most commonly are the peanuts, hard food, hot dog, grapes, beans and seeds. After the foreign body aspiration, that foreign body that can be settled into three anatomic sites like larynx, trachea and bronchus. There are three stages for the foreign body aspiration. First stage we consider is initial phase. Second is the asymptomatic phase. Third phase, that is the complication phase. In the initial phase, choking and gasping, coughing or airway obstruction at the time of aspiration can be seen. In the asymptomatic phase, the subsequent lodging of the object that will lead to the relaxation of reflexes that often results in a reduction or cessation of the symptoms and it may last for hours to weeks. In the complication phase, the foreign body that will produce erosion or obstruction that will lead to pneumonia, atelectasis or abscess. In the foreign body in the nose, the commonly exhibiting symptoms are difficulty in breathing through the affected nostril, feeling of something in the nose, foul smelling, bloody nasal discharge, irritability, particularly which can be seen in infants and they will irritable and they will always cry, irritation or pain in the nose. In children can be seen. The diagnosis is by patient history, rhinoscopy examination and also by the radiograph, we can find out this foreign body's presence. The method of removal, that is by under general or local anesthesia, we will visualize and remove this foreign body. In the earlier slide, we discussed this choking. It is the interruption of respiration by an internal obstruction of airway, which is usually by a food item or small airway. In this figure, we can understand this picture. It is a universal choking sign holding the neck with one or both hands. The recognition of severity of choking, various signs are if there is good air exchange and the victim who can make sounds and can cough loudly, may wheeze between coughs, then the block is a mild degree. In this actions we are carried out are spontaneous breathing and coughing. Encourage the child for spontaneous breathing and coughing. If the signs are like the child cannot breathe or increased respiratory difficulty, and the child has a cough that has no sound, and the child cannot talk or make sound, and the child may make a high pitched noise, and there is a possibility of cyanosis and make the universal choking sign, then the block is a severe form. In this situation, ask the victim whether he is choking or not. If the victim is nodded yes and who cannot talk, then it is a severe airway obstruction and try to relieve the obstruction. In this, we follow the Himmlich maneuver. It is a sudden forceful abdominal thrusts that are given to the victim slightly above the belly button. Each thrust push the air from the lungs like a cough, and this can help remove the object blocking the airway. And also we will follow this back blows. In a victim with a severe choking and is conscious, make the victim lean and well formed. Give 5 back blows between the shoulder blades and with it using the heel of the rescuer's hand. This is the Himmlich maneuver, and making a fist and then cover it with the non-dominant hand, then make the thrust on the abdominal wall below the breastbone. And in the infants and all, we can make the back thrust by placing it on the place the infant's stomach down across your forearm and give 5 thumbs on the infant's back with the heel of your hand. And if you are alone in your home and there is an occurrence of this obstruction, then place a fist above the navel while grasping fist with the other hand and lean over a chair or a countertop. Then drive your fist towards yourself with a upward thrust. If the situation is alone, if any child, we can teach them any alone. In such situations, we can perform this. If the foreign body is in the larynx, the laryngeal foreign bodies usually causes complete or partial airway obstruction. And the symptoms can be seen are croup, like laryngo, tracheobronchitis, because this croup may be evidenced because the sounds which is generated, which can be seen during the croup, that will be formed. And also the stridor sound, it is a high pitched musical breathing sound, it is an abnormal sound. Cough, then hoarseness of voice, dyspnea, painful swallowing and difficulty in phonation. The diagnosis is by fluoroscopic examination and by other radiological investigation. The management is by the Himmlich maneuver, tracheostomy and laryngoscopy. If the foreign body, which is situated in the tracheobronchial tree, the main symptoms are episodes of coughing, intermittent or continuous dyspnea with cyanosis, pain and intermittent hoarseness of voice. And this site, which depends on the size and shape of the foreign body. Most common site is the right main bronchus because it's straight angle of origin from the trachea. If the foreign body is retained for longer period, it will lead to accumulation of secretions, tracheitis or bronchitis with edema, swelling and granulations, bleeding and blood stained secretions will be present, inspiratory and expiratory valvular stenosis, partial obstruction of the lower airway and emphysema, atelectasis or overinflation of the post-stenotic part of the lung. The nursing management for foreign body obstruction is recognize the signs of foreign body aspiration and implement the immediate measures to relieve the obstruction. Immediate removal of the foreign body, which will prevent the local tissue inflammation. prevent the secondary infection and treat with the appropriate antibiotics, educate the parents and caretakers about the emergency procedure. The prevention of this foreign body obstruction is by keeping small objects out of reach of children, and also the adults should not show the negative behaviors like putting pins and other small objects in the mouth, and also educate parents about the hazards of aspiration. Next condition is, next we are moving to the poisoning. A poison, it is any substance that when ingested, inhaled or absorbed in relatively small amounts can cause damage to a structure or disturbance of body function by its chemical action. Poisoning is a common medical emergency in childhood. In children under 5 years of age, essentially all poisons are accidental, and 75% of poisoning episodes involve ingestion of substances which are non-toxic or have mild toxicity. According to the Toxic Exposure Surveillance System report of American Association of Poison Control, there occurs around more than 2 million human poisoning exposure. Among them, more than 50% of occur in children younger than 5 years of age. And the ingestion is the most common route of poisoning exposure. It is around 77%. The dermal exposure, which is by 7.5%, inhalation 6%, and by the ophthalmic exposure, that is by 5%. The gastrointestinal disturbances may occur. The common clinical manifestations after poisoning are nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain and diarrhea. In the respiratory and circulatory system, unexplained cyanosis can be seen. Shock, and immediately the child will go to collapse. In the central nervous system, the child will exhibit lethargy, sudden loss of consciousness, convulsions, dizziness, stupor and coma. In the patient evaluation, first the description of toxin, label, the product's name and ingredients along with their concentrations are obtained from the label. Estimate can be accomplished by counting the remaining tablets or measuring the remaining volume of liquid. It is better to overestimate than underestimate the remaining parts. And also the for inhalation, ocular or dermal exposure, the concentration of the offending agent and the length of contact time with the material should be determined. The time of exposure, for some products, the toxic manifestations may be delayed for hours to day. Know the lapse between exposure and onset of symptoms, and it will influence the medical evaluation. Then progression of symptoms, nature and progression of symptoms is very helpful for assessing the need for immediate life support, the prognosis and the type of intervention. After the poisoning exposure, the primary assessment and interventions include maintain an open airway, attain the control of the airway, ventilation, oxygenation, identify the poison, continue the focused assessment, obtain blood and urine tests for toxicology screening, monitor the fluid and electrolyte imbalance. The supportive care include initiate IV access, administer oxygen for respiratory depression, monitor and treat the shock, prevent aspiration of gastric contents by positioning, use of oropharyngeal airway and using the suctioning. Give supportive care to maintain oral vital organ, and also insert an indwelling urinary catheter to monitor the renal function. Support the patient having seizures, and the seizures may sometimes the seizures that may occur due to oxygen deprivation. Monitor and treat complications, and also if also carry out a psychiatric evaluation in adolescent children. For preventing absorption, most toxins are rapidly absorbed from the gastrointestinal tract or through inhalation. Prompt action to remove the toxin and minimize the contact with the absorptive surface is crucial. The dermal and ocular decontamination can be accomplished by flushing the affected area with tepid water. Flushing for a minimum of 10 minutes is recommended for ocular exposure. And for the alkaline corrosive, may require for long periods of flushing. Avoid flowing of water from one eye to other, and the most liquid products are absorbed within 30 to 45 minutes of ingestion, and the solid dosage form, it will take around 1 to 2 hours for the absorption. In this treatment, we will, for avoidance of the absorption of this poison, activated charcoal will be administered. It is an effective means to decrease or prevent the intestinal absorption of a few drugs or toxins. The activated charcoal, which is prepared with a large, it has a large absorptive surface area. Its usual dose is 10 to 50 gram for a child and 50 to 100 gram for an adolescent or an adult. It is commonly mixed as a slurry in a water or a solution of sorbitol, and the flavoring may be added. If the child is not voluntarily swallow the charcoal slurry, it can be instilled by nasogastric tube. Then next is the cathartics. It is used in conjugation with the activated charcoal to hasten the clearance of the charcoal and the toxin complex. The commonly used cathartics are sorbitol. Its maximum dose is 1 gram per kg. The magnesium sulfate, it is in another form. Its maximum dose is 250 ml per kg. This cathartics should be used cautiously in children because of the risk of dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. Next method is whole bowel irrigation. It is the installation of large volume of fluid around 30 ml per kg per hour for a non-absorbed polyethylene glycol electrolyte solution. It is used in cases of iron, drug packets or cocaine packets, poisoning. Next method is emesis by administering syrup ipecac. The onset of emesis will be 2 to 30 minutes after the dosing, and the dose is 10 ml for infants, 15 to 30 ml for children, and 1 to 12 year children, 30 ml for older and adults. Next is the gastric lavage. It is used in older children. Other forms are diuresis and dialysis will also perform. Then providing antidote. An antidote is a chemical or physiological antagonist that will neutralize the poison and administer the specific antidote as early as possible to reverse or diminish the effect of toxin. The commonly using antidote are N-acetylcysteine for acetaminophen, atropine for OP poisoning, naloxone for narcotics poisoning. The prevention of this poisoning, it is by the effective storage in a locked cabinet and handling of dangerous substance. The toxic substance never be stored with the food containers, and also advise the parents to label poisonous substance with stickers. Next condition is the dehydration. It is a condition that can occur with the excess loss of water and other body fluids. The dehydration that may result from decreased intake, increased output in cases of renal and gastrointestinal, and also in cases of insensible water loss, and also due to the shift of fluid like ascites, effusion, and also due to the capillary leak of fluid in case of burns and sepsis. The first step in caring for the child with the dehydration is to assess the degree of dehydration, which dictates both the urgency of the situation and the volume of fluid needed for the rehydration. In which this dehydration that may occur due to diarrhea, it is a common form of fluid loss in children, and it will lead to electrolyte disorders. In the unusual patient with a significant diarrhea and limited ability to take oral fluid, it is important to have a plan for replacing the excessive stool losses. The volume of stool should be measured, and an equal volume of replacement solution should be given. The replacement of fluid for diarrhea is in diarrhea, the average sodium loss is around 55 milliequivalent per liter, potassium loss is 25 milliequivalent per liter, bicarbonate loss is 15 milliequivalent per liter. The approach to replacement of this ongoing loss, that is by a solution of N5D5, 30 milliequivalent per liter of sodium bicarbonate with the 20 milliequivalent per liter of KCl. And here the replace the stool amount that is considered the loss of fluid, and that is replaced in every 1 to 2 hour. Next, dehydration that will be takes place by the loss of gastric fluid. It may be via either emesis, NG suction, and it may cause dehydration. In most patients with either condition have impaired oral intake or fluids, and hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis are also common. The associated urinary loss of potassium, it is an important cause of hypokalemia in this situation. Then replacement of fluid or in emesis, in such conditions, the loss of sodium is around 60 milliequivalent per liter, potassium loss is 10 milliequivalent per liter, chloride loss is 90 milliequivalent per liter. The solution, which is replaced a normal saline with the 10 milliequivalent per liter of KCl and replace out with the every 1 to 6 hours. The clinical evaluation of dehydration, it is classified mainly mild dehydration, moderate dehydration and severe dehydration. In the mild dehydration, less than 5% of infant and also less than 3% of in older children and adult can be seen. The pulse that will be normal or it may be increased, decreased urine output, the child will be thirsty and normal physical findings will be there. In moderate dehydration, it can be seen in 5 to 10% in an infant and 3 to 6% in older and adult. Tachycardia will be there, little or no urine output will be there. The child will be irritable, lethargic, sunken eyes and also sunken fontanella can be seen, decreased tears, dry mucous membrane, mild delay in elasticity, delayed capillary refill which is more than 1.5 seconds and also the cool pale skin will be there. In case of severe dehydration, it occurs in more than 10% of infant and also more than 6% in older children and adult. The peripheral pulse that will be weak and sometime it will be absent and the blood pressure that will be decreased, no urine output, very sunken eyes and fontanel. There will not be any tears. And parched mucous membrane, the extreme dryness that will lead to perforation and bleeding will be there. That is the parched mucous membrane, delayed elasticity, then very delayed capillary refill, that is more than 3 seconds, cold and motileless skin, limp posture and depressed, and the child will depressed consciousness will be there. The dehydration mainly other than mild, moderate, severe, it can be other classified as isotonic dehydration, hyponatremic dehydration and hypernatremic dehydration. In hypernatremic dehydration, the neonate is with a poor intake of breast milk. In any child with the loss of hypotonic fluid or poor water intake, in diarrhea and poor oral intake because of anorexia and emesis, that may lead to hypernatremic dehydration. The hyponatremic dehydration that occurs in child with the diarrhea who is taking large quantities of low salt fluid like water or other formula. In the hyponatremic dehydration, the pathogenesis of hyponatremic dehydration, that is the combination of sodium and water loss and water retention to compensate for the volume depletion. The patient has a pathologic increase in fluid loss and the lost fluid contains sodium that will lead to hypernatremia. Diarrhea has an diarrhea in which the sodium loss is around 50 milliequivalent per liter. The replacing diarrheal fluid with the water which has almost no sodium, it will lead to reduction of serum sodium concentration and it will lead to hyponatremia. The volume depletion stimulates synthesis of antidiuretic hormone which will result in reduced renal water excretion. Hence the body's usual mechanism for preventing hyponatremia, the renal water excretion that will be blocked. The risk of hyponatremia is further increased if the volume depletion is as a result of loss of fluid with a higher sodium concentration. It may occur in renal salt wasting, third space losses, diarrhea with a high sodium content, like in cholera. Next is the hypernatremic dehydration. It is a most dangerous form of dehydration because the complication of hypernatremia and of therapy. The hypernatremia, it will lead to the serious neurological damage including central nervous system, hemorrhage and thrombosis. The damage appears to secondary to the movement of water from the brain cells into the hypertonic extracellular fluid. It will lead to brain cell shrinkage and also tearing of blood vessels within the brain. The children will be lethargic, irritable when touched and hypernatremia causes fever, hypertonicity and hyperreflexia. With overly rapid lowering of the extracellular osmolality during the correction of hypernatremia, an osmotic gradient that will be formed which will causes water movement from extracellular space into the cells of the brain which will lead to cerebral edema. The symptoms of the cerebral edema which can ranges from seizure to brain herniation, at last it will lead to death. The physical examination findings are the presence of sunken eyes, pinching and gently twisting the skin of the abdomen or thoracic wall which detect the tending of the skin, which is assessing for assessing the turgor and elasticity, the tended skin that will remain in a pinched position rather than springing quickly back to the normal. These are exception in premature infants and also in severely malnourished children. The laboratory findings are the serum sodium concentration, which determines the type of dehydration, the metabolic acidosis in the stool, bicarbonate losses in diarrhea, then secondary renal insufficiency and lactic acidosis from shock, the anion gap that differentiates the various causes of metabolic acidosis, low serum potassium concentration due to diarrheal loss, and also the volume depletion without renal parenchymal renal injury that will lead to increase in the blood urea nitrogen value with no change in the creatinine value. If there is no renal parenchymal injury, that will lead to bun elevation without any change of the creatinine. And others are hemoconcentration from dehydration that will cause increase in hematocrit level, hemoglobin, and also the serum protein level. After rehydration, these values will be normalized. A normal hemoglobin concentration during acute dehydration that may mask the underlying anemia. A decreased albumin level in a dehydrated patient, which will suggest the chronic diseases like malnutrition, nephrotic syndrome, liver disease, and acute process such as capillary leak. The calculation of fluid deficit, determining the fluid deficit which necessitates the clinical determination of percentage of dehydration and multiplication of the percentage by the patient's weight. For example, the percentage of the dehydration, that is 10%, for a child's weight, that is 10 kg. So multiply this 10% by this 10 kg. By that we can calculate this fluid deficit. The management of hyponatremic dehydration. The goal of this hyponatremic dehydration, that is the correction of intravascular volume depletion with isotonic fluids such as normosaline and renal lactate, which has to be administered at more than 12 milliequivalent per liter over the first 24 hours. Then potassium delivery, which is adjusted according to the initial serum potassium level and according to the patient's renal function. If the patients with the neurological symptoms like seizure as a result of hyponatremia need to receive acute infusion of hypertonic saline, that is 3% saline, the serum sodium to increase the serum sodium concentration. To minimize the risk of cerebral edema during the correction, the serum sodium concentration should not increase by more than 12 milliequivalent per liter in every 24 hours. The initial resuscitation of hyponatremic dehydration that requires restoration of the intravascular volume with the normal saline. The renal lactate should not be used because it is in cases of hyponatremia because it is more hypotonic than normal saline, which will lead to too rapid decrease in the serum sodium concentration and by multiple fluid bolus administration. This is the treatment of hypernatremic dehydration. Next is the hypernatremic dehydration. In such cases, initially we can manage by oral fluids, then consciously in cases of infant formula because of its low sodium concentration and has high free water content. The less hypotonic fluid such as oral dehydration solution may be appropriate used initially. If oral intake is allowed, its contribution to free water delivery must be taken into account. An adjustment in the intravenous fluid next after starting and also we have to concurrently manage with this intravenous fluid. The approaches for the severe dehydration that include in the first initial resuscitation phase, rapid restoration of the intravascular volume and treatment of the shock with the normal saline and renal lactate. The fluid bolus administered at a rate of 20 ml per kg over 20 minutes. The child with the severe dehydration require multiple fluid bolus as fast as possible. In a child with a known or probable metabolic alkalosis, renal lactate should not be used because the lactate would worsen the alkalosis. Then the colloids such as blood and others that can be administered in cases of anemia and there is an event of acute blood loss. The plasma for children with the coagulopathy and also 5% albumin for the child with the hypoalbuminemia can be administered. The signs of clinical improvement that include a lower heart rate, then normalization of the blood pressure, improved perfusion, better urine output, and the child will be alert. With the adequate intravascular volume, it is appropriate to plan for the fluid therapy for the next 24 hours. This is the fluid management of dehydration. The potassium, which is not usually included in the intravenous fluid until the patient void and normal renal function is documented, and via the measurement of bun and creatinine, because the potassium that will lead to the, if it is adequate, there is no adequate urine output, hyperkalemia will be there and it will lead to arrhythmias. Monitoring and adjusting therapy. The vital signs are the indicators of intravascular volume status. The child with a decreased blood pressure and an increased heart rate will benefit from the fluid bolus administration. The central venous pressure is an indicator of fluid status in the critically ill child with a shock. The patient's intake output chart is important in the dehydrated child. The urine output is useful for evaluating the success of therapy. The signs of dehydration on physical examination suggest the need for continued rehydration. The signs of fluid overload suggest edema, pulmonary congestion. These are the signs of overhydration. An accurate daily weight measurement, which is critical for the management of dehydrated child, and also the gain of the weight, that is also the successful sign of therapy. And also should monitor the electrolytes like sodium, potassium. Next is respiratory emergencies. This respiratory emergencies, which are quite common after this foreign body aspiration. Infants and young children are particularly prone to decompensation resulting from respiratory embarrassment because of their small airway, high metabolic requirement, and immature musculature. The respiratory distress is defined as sudden onset difficulty in breathing, increased respiratory rate, chest indrawing, difficulty in feeding, speech, irritability, head nodding, altered sensorium and cyanosis. The precipitating events and causes of respiratory distress in infants and children are nasal block, asthma, bronchiolitis, pneumonia, acute laryngotracheobronchitis, epiglottitis, pneumothorax, empyema, atelectasis, hypersensitivity pneumonitis, metabolic acidosis, congestive cardiac failure, acute neuromuscular paralysis, central hyperventilation include that may be psychogenic. The clinical indicators of this respiratory arrest are, they are known as red flag signs: increased respiratory rate, increased respiratory effort, inadequate respiratory rate, effort or chest excursion, decreased peripheral breath sounds, gasping or grunting respirations, decreased level of consciousness or response to pain, poor skeletal muscle tone, cyanosis, the saturation less than 90%. The treatment modalities are IV fluids, antibiotics if indicated, then oxygen inhalation, inhaled medications, epinephrine, salbutamol, inhaled steroids, etc., and also the ventilatory support. The oxygen inhalation method, which is by the hood, face masks, nasal catheter, and nasal catheter with some modification. The maximum flow of oxygen, which can be attained by hood, around 6 to 8 liter per minute, which is best tolerated for infants, provide an FiO2 of 60 to 80%. For the face mask, it deliver a 2 to 4 liter per minute, which is less tolerated by the infants and toddlers. It may be used in older children, which provide an FiO2 of 40%. The nasal catheter, which provide 1 to 2 liter per minute, which is least tolerated by the children, and it is less effective method for providing oxygen. It may be useful in chronic children with chronic respiratory problems. This nasal catheter with some modification, which deliver a 1 to 2 liter per minute, it is better tolerated, and it deliver a FiO2 of 40%. It can be used in children with a mild respiratory problem. First one is the nasal block in respiratory emergencies, which can seen in young infants. History of cold will be the cough and difficulty in feeding, irritability, better when kept against the shoulder. Child will improve. Then sucks 2 to 3 times, then stops and again sucks on breast, which can be seen cries excessively, but examination may not show any other abnormalities except nasal block. The management is by look for vital parameters like heart rate, respiratory rate, capillary refilling time, signs of meningeal irritation. If nothing serious is detected, instill the normal saline drops both the nostrils and observe the feeding. If the child is feeding well, ambulatory treatment with the saline drops for 4 to 6 hourly, gentle suction of nasopharynx if there is thick secretions. Not feeding well and if there is other any dangerous signs, then the child should be hospitalized for observation. Next is the acute asthma. It is a recurrent cough, wheeze, breathlessness with the sum of the following. The child will have past history of illness and good response to the bronchodilators. Then the child will have family history of asthma, precipitating factors, associated allergic diathesis like rhinitis, dermatitis. Then also there will be wheezing on auscultation. The treatment of mild attack is by the short-acting beta-2 agonist, 4 to 6 puffs through metered dose inhaler, spacer and mask or by nebulizer. MDI spacer plus mask, which is used for an infant. For a grown-up child, MDI plus spacer is used. Repeat every 50 to 20 minutes for maximum 3 times. If response is sustained less than 4 hours, the start first dose of rescue steroid. If the case is worsening and if there is no response, start oxygen therapy. Short-acting beta agonist should be provided, nebulized at a 20 minute and 3 hourly, and also provide the MDI spacer mask puff. Then next is acute bronchiolitis. Etiology is it may be viral and also respiratory syncytial virus may be caused. The history of upper respiratory tract infection in any family members will be a significant history. The cold for 2 to 4 days followed by cough, wheeze and rapid respiration. The first episode of wheeze with the fever, cold considered the acute bronchiolitis. Assess the severity by lower chest drawing, difficulty in feeding, excessive crying due to hypoxemia, cyanosis and oxygen saturation. Infant with increased respiratory rate and there is no chest indrawing, feeding well and if the saturation is more than 95%, it is considered a mild disease. In moderate to severe disease, the infant is having a chest indrawing, difficulty in feeding, cyanosis, and the saturation will be less than 95%. The investigations are in mild disease, there is no need. Then normal or minimal increase in the total leukocyte count with the relative lymphocytosis can be seen. In the chest X-ray, hyperinflation and small atelectasis can be seen. The management of acute bronchiolitis in mild illness, there is ambulatory, if ambulatory treatment is possible, give a dose of inhaled salbutamol and see response after 15 to 30 minutes. If there is a good response, continue oral or inhaled salbutamol for 5 to 7 days. If the nasal block, saline drops, SOS before the feeds. And home remedies for control of the cough, encourage for feeding, watch for feeding and also observe for chest indrawing, cyanosis, and bring the child to hospital or clinic if the signs are visible. And also the paracetamol must be administered if there is an incidence of fever. In case of severe disease, the child must be hospitalized and provide oxygen, and also in cases of severe cases, we will provide epinephrine and bronchodilators for inhalation. Next is the pneumonia. It is a common cause of morbidity and leading cause of mortality in children below 5 years of age. The common organisms are bacteria, which accounts for 40 to 60%, virus, which accounts for 40 to 44%, a typical pneumonia around 10 to 20%, mixed around 10 to 20%. The diagnosis of pneumonia clinically, according to the WHO case definition, reasonable but include many non-pneumonic. The children with the wheeze, upper respiratory tract infection with a fever, who is clinically diagnosed as pneumonia. In the chest X-ray, which is the gold standard for pneumonia diagnosis, but may be done only in case of children requiring hospitalization, not responding to the ambulatory treatment, suspecting staphylococcal pneumonia. The severity assessment and treatment of pneumonia. The clinical category, if the child is having cough or cold, the essential features are no fast breathing and no indicators of severe or very severe pneumonia. The home care is possible for the cough and also for the paracetamol for the fever. In pneumonia, the fast breathing, according to the age, 2 months to 12 months, respiratory rate which is more than 50, then and also 12 months to 5 years, the respiratory rate which is more than 40 per minute, and no indicators for severe or very severe pneumonia. home care by oral cotrimoxazole, amoxicillin, ampicillin, or IM procaine penicillin will be administered. In case of severe pneumonia, there is features of lower chest syndrome, nasal flaring, no indicators of severe or very severe pneumonia. The treatment categories: the patient child will be hospitalized, IM or IV penicillin or ampicillin will be administered. In case of very severe pneumonia, features like central cyanosis, unable to drink or breastfeed, there is convulsions, lethargy, unconsciousness, severe respiratory distress, that the child will be hospitalized, give oxygen, IM or IV chloramphenicol or ampicillin plus gentamicin will be administered. Next is the croup. It is also known as laryngotracheobronchitis. It is a common cause of upper airway obstruction. The most viral agent is parainfluenza type 1. The clinical features are hoarseness of voice, barking cough, inspiratory stridor, and varying degree of respiratory distress. The assessment of croup, according to the assessment, it is classified mild, moderate, and severe. In case of mild, the general appearance will be happy, feels well interested in surrounding. In case of moderate, fussy but active and comforted by patients. In case of severe, the child will be restlessness, agitated, altered sensorium. In mild cases, stridor on coughing and crying can be seen. There will not be any stridor if the child is on rest. In case of moderate case, stridor at rest can be seen and worsening can be seen on crying, coughing and agitation. The stridor at rest and worsens in severe cases, the stridor that can be seen at rest and which will be worsening during crying, coughing and agitation. The respiratory distress, it will not be present in mild cases. In moderate cases, tachypnea, tachycardia and chest retractions can be seen. In severe cases, there will be a marked respiratory distress, tachypnea will be present, tachycardia and chest retractions can be seen. In mild cases, the oxygen saturation that will be more than 92% in room air. In moderate cases, the oxygen saturation that will be less than 92% in room air. In severe cases, less than 92% in room air with cyanosis can be seen. The croup management: in mild severity, oral dexamethasone with 0.6 mg per kg or nebulized budesonide with 2 mg single dose will be administered. In moderate cases, Dexa 0.6 mg per kg, IM or IV, and nebulization will be provided. Reassess at every 2 to 4 hours. Discharge if there is no cyanosis and chest retractions and there is no audible stridor. Next is the status epilepticus. It is defined as a continuous convulsion which is lasting longer than 20 to 30 minutes, or the occurrence of serial convulsions between there is no return of consciousness. There are three types of static epilepsy in children. That is, one is the prolonged febrile seizure, idiopathic status epilepticus, in which the seizure in the absence of underlying CNS insult can be seen. The third one is the symptomatic status epilepticus, in which the seizure which is due to the underlying neurological disorder or metabolic abnormality. The etiology of the status epilepsy is: it is followed by sudden withdrawal of any anticonvulsants, non-compliant to the drugs, initial presentation of epilepsy, the sleep deprivation and recurrent infection. Prolonged convulsion may be the initial manifestation of encephalitis. Prolonged convulsion that may be long-term complication of meningitis that may be associated with hippocampus damage. Inborn errors of metabolism in newborn. Electrolyte abnormalities, hypocalcemia and hypoglycemia. The algorithm for management of status epileptics: in this first 0 minute, the drugs IV access available is administer injection lorazepam 0.1 mg per kg IV, maximum of 4 mg and injection midazolam 0.1 mg to 0.2 mg per kg IV, maximum 5 mg. If the IV access which is not available, buccal midazolam 0.3 mg per kg, maximum 5 mg, or diazepam 0.5 mg per kg, maximum 10 mg will be administered. The general measures assessing are airway breathing circulation, establish the IV access, also monitor the temperature. Then investigations like glucose, sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, that must be monitored. At the 5 minutes, injection lorazepam 0.1 mg per kg IV, maximum dose of 4 mg, and injection midazolam 0.15 to 0.2 mg per kg IV, maximum midazolam administration is 5 mg. And also during that time, oxygen inhalation should be provided, cardiorespiratory support, monitoring of ECG, BP, saturation, then other investigations like glucose and also CRP, complete blood count, AED level, toxin screen, and blood urea nitrogen must be monitored. At the 10 minutes, the drugs administered are IV phenytoin, 20 mg per kg, maximum dose is 1000 mg in normal saline at 1 mg per kg minute, and at a maximum dose is 50 mg per minute, or ingestion force phenytoin, 20 mg per kg, rate of 3 mg per kg per minute, repeat ingestion phenytoin 10 mg per kg, if ingestion force phenytoin 10 mg per kg, if no response to the initial dose. The general measures are check whether the child is on AED, then investigations like glucose, sodium, potassium, calcium and magnesium. If there is a refractory seizure even after the 10 minutes of phenytoin and force phenytoin in administration, IV valproate 20 to 30 mg per kg IV at a maximum of 6 mg per kg minute is administered, or IV phenobarbital 20 mg per kg in NS at 1.5 mg per kg minute are administered. Repeat 10 mg per kg if there is no response to initial dose, or IV levetiracetam if liver disease or any metabolic disease, coagulopathy and chemotherapy is carrying, at a dose of 20 to 30 mg per kg at 5 mg per kg per minute infusion. During that time, continue the monitoring as above as vasopressors. If needed, identify and treat the medical conditions and electrolyte disturbances. Then investigations like CT of the head, lumbar puncture for CNS infection, and also EEG must be performed. For the conclusion, the childhood emergencies are the most pressing public health problems in countries. Infectious disease and injuries are the major among them. Physicians and nurses who provide pediatric emergency care play a pivotal role in integrating them. Today we...
Okay, thank you Anu for covering this topic in an extensive manner. But there were few things which she could not cover because of the shortage of time. So please remember, some more emergencies can be anaphylaxis, secondary to drug ingestion, or secondary to food allergy, or secondary to mismatched blood transfusion. This is an emergency. Then you can have children with endocrinological disorder. They may at time present to you with severe hypoglycemia, or with uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. Sometimes they can land up with diabetic ketoacidosis. Only in neurology she has covered status epilepticus. You can have coma because of any reason, that is also an emergency. So these were few conditions which could, and infectious diseases, that is another area which she could not pay much attention to. So you are requested to read all these emergencies. And in nutshell, I would like to just summarize how to manage a child with a critical illness. As soon as child comes to you, you are not aware of what problem the child has. Just looking at the child, so initial assessment is called PAT triangle, P-A-T, PAT triangle assessment, pediatric assessment triangle. PAT assessment is pediatric assessment triangle, in which we look for three important things, that is ABC. A stands for appearance. Please remember, this ABC is different from ABC which we learn in primary survey. This is a pediatric assessment triangle where A stands for appearance of the child. How is the appearance of the child? By looking at the child, you get to know whether child is seriously ill, mildly ill, or is stable. For example, if he is lethargic, or if he is comatose, or he is irritable, he is anxious, he is inconsolable. So these are the few manifestations that get covered under appearance.
So please pay attention to the appearance of the child, then look at the breathing pattern, how child is breathing, whether he is breathing normally or he has irregular breathing or he has fast breathing, because that is also going to help you to decide the future course of action. And the third component of PAT is C, which is referring to color, color of the child. Color could be a pink color. Pink color is supposed to be a normal color of a child, while pallor can be seen in conditions, or mottling can be seen in conditions like shock. You can have a child with hypovolemic shock, you can have a child with septic shock, vasoactive shock, neurogenic shock, any type of shock. The child's appearance makes you to reach to the conclusion that child is seriously ill. So please pay attention to his color. And if he is cyanosed, definitely there is some kind of respiratory component. Some hypoxemia is already set into the picture. So these are the three important components we consider when we are doing initial assessment. Remember, triaging is an important component. And I'm sure you know what ETAT is. So remember this assessment. And then thereafter comes the primary survey and secondary survey. Primary survey and secondary survey, you all know this has, primary survey has A, B, C, D, and E. These are the components: airway, breathing, circulation, disability, referring to the level of consciousness, and then exposure. While in secondary survey, whenever you are approaching a child, a sick child, a critical ill child, or a child in emergency, do a primary survey followed by a secondary assessment. Secondary survey would include focus history, detailed examination, and then you further manage. In some literature, you will also see there is another way. This is called EII, that is, you evaluate the condition of the child, you identify the problem, and then you decide the intervention. So this is a kind of a decision-making cycle which we refer to during pediatric emergency or during any kind of critical illness. So with this, we come to the end of the session. If you have any questions, you can write them down. In the afternoon also, we are trying to arrange another session on pediatric emergencies by Dr. Kanaram. We'll be informing you about the time. It is either going to be from 2 to 3 or 3 to 4. So just be in touch with us. We'll be giving you message through WhatsApp, and you can have another revision related to the pediatric emergencies. Thank you. Call him, we can stop it. Whatever you sent me yesterday, that was very, very sketchy, superficial. There was no need to deal with the dehydration so much in depth. You have to include all the emergencies, and when it comes to emergencies, you have a common management. You have a specific management, but in general, you have to just pay attention to the emergency management followed by specific management for the particular condition.